Good afternoon, everybody. How are you? I hope you enjoyed General McDew's speech as much as I did. Those of you that got to go to lunch, it was inspiring to say the least, and to see a career Air Force officer get up there and talk so eloquently about the sea services just did my heart good. So I welcome you all here. What little I have to say will be nowhere near as eloquent, but we've got great panelists here. So I want to thank the Navy League for giving us the opportunity to have this panel to sit alongside with our sister service, the Navy, our international partners, to talk about matters of significant national interest. America, for those of you that don't know, I expect you know, or you probably took a wrong turn at the passageway there. We have a fourth coast, and we are an Arctic nation, and as such, what happens in the Arctic matters and is important to global security. As many of you know, in the last couple of years, as a member of the Arctic Council, we've been quite busy as the chair of that, and we prepare to hand that over to our comrades from Finland next month. And just last month in Boston, our commandant passed over the Arctic Coast Guard Forum to the Finns up in Boston. I'm delighted to have this panel here because they are truly experts. I got to have lunch with them, and we talked about several things, and I think you're going to be delighted by them. This is about, it's advertised as about Arctic security, but it's not just military security. Those of you that are familiar with that part of the world, this is, has to do with economic security, it has to do with border security, it has to do with environmental security, and these gentlemen are certainly well equipped to speak to all of that. For the U.S., the Coast Guard is the primary presence in the Arctic, and we do that primarily through seasonal presence. These days, but I will tell you, after you listen to these folks, you will, I think, agree that seasonal presence is insufficient moving forward, and that's why our icebreaker recapitalization program is so important. I know we've got members from the industry here, and that's probably why you're here, because you're interested in our requirements and our interest in the Arctic, and so I thank you for being here. The Coast Guard needs 3 heavy icebreakers and 3 medium icebreakers to assure year-round access to this important part of the world, and I think we are on the way towards getting there. As sea ice recedes and human activity increases in the Arctic, there's greater demand for Coast Guard and Coast Guard activities there because of the tyranny of distance, the atmospheric anomalies. It's a difficult place to serve and work and obtain that maritime domain awareness that we all are keen on, and the being aware of what's happening there and threats, and also the attendance to maritime disasters. For all these reasons and more, this panel is important, our work there is important, and so I am thrilled to have these gentlemen here. Without any further ado, I'll just quickly introduce our panelists. Each one of them, starting with Admiral Wang, will give a 10-minute or so presentation, then we'll open it up to your questions. So get ready for the questions. First, to my left is Rear Admiral Nils Wang, of the Kingdom of Denmark. He is one of Denmark's leading experts, and I would say an expert in the world, on geopolitical and international governance in the Arctic. Before he was a commandant of the Danish Defense College, he was head of the Royal Danish Navy. He sailed in the Arctic waters for many years, 5 specifically around Greenland. He and I talked about that, and he is a tremendous expert, and so he's got a great presentation. I think you would be well served to ask him questions. Next to him is Mike Emerson, my colleague from the Coast Guard. Mike is the Director of Marine Transportation Systems for the Coast Guard, and he's our senior Arctic policy advisor. Mr. Emerson manages a broad portfolio of navigation, waterway, and bridge programs, and he's also responsible for all of our polar Antarctic programs. He's a 30-year veteran of active duty service in the U.S. Coast Guard, and I'm thankful to have him here. To his left is the Oceanographer of the Navy, Rear Admiral Tim Gallaudet. Admiral Gallaudet is the Oceanographer and the Navigator of the Navy, and Commander of the Navy Meteorological and Oceanography Command. Prior to assuming his current position, he served as Chief of Staff of the Chief of Naval Operations as the Deputy Oceanographer of the Navy. We welcome you, Tim. Thanks. And then certainly last but not least is the new, brand new, barely a month old Commissioner of our great partners just to the north, the Canadian Coast Guard, Jeffery Hutchinson. Prior to being appointed to lead the Canadian Coast Guard in March of this year, he served in the position as a Deputy Commissioner for Strategy and Shipbuilding from 2015 to 2017. And prior to this, Commissioner Hutchinson held the position as Director General, National Strategies, and Director General, Integrated Business Management Services. So I think you'll agree we've got a great panel here, true experts in this important region to our nation and to many nations of the world. And so that's enough of me. I will turn it over to Admiral Wang to give his presentation. Please welcome him.
Thank you very much, Admiral. Thank you for the kind introduction. And also thank you to the Navy League from me for inviting me for this great event. Thank you. In my present job as Commandant of the Royal Danish Defence College, I frequently have coffee chats with different countries' ambassadors in Copenhagen when they come by to have a talk about the Arctic. And not long ago, the Chinese defense attaché came to my office and he said, "Admiral, the Arctic is hot." and I think that is exactly what everybody thinks and talks about. That is that the Arctic is hot in several ways of perception, you could argue. Actually, the interest, and if you look at countries who is applying to be permanent observers in the Arctic Council, you actually sense a little bit like in the old days in the Soviet Union when people was queuing up in front of a shop. And people just queued up without even taking notice of which kind of shop it was, because if people queue up, it must be interesting in the other end. I'm not sure that this is a one-to-one relation to the Arctic, but sometimes it can appear in that way. What I will do in the next 9-10 minutes or so is walk you through a couple of maps on the screen here, because I think when you're talking about the Arctic, it is very important that you have this region and the magnificent size of the region in front of you, because I think that is necessary to understand some of the dynamics that I will allude to. And of course, it will only be some of them, and I hope that in the discussion period we can maybe go a little further in depth with some of them, but then it's up to you to find out what we are going to talk about. Next slide, please. Many people have the perception that the Arctic is a homogeneous region impacted by the same framework conditions. And as you can see on this map, and I haven't brought it to convince you that the ice is retracting in the polar seas, but merely to actually illustrate that you have several regions in the Arctic with different conditions. You have the Black Arctic, as I call it here. That is the ice-free part of the Arctic. And that is the area where you will have most of the human activities, whether that is commercial activities or being military activities. That is the reason why the Russians have most of their military buildup in that part of the region, and by the way, the reason why the Norwegians also have a lot of their activities in the northern part. That is because you can. That is because it's actually, you are able to access the Arctic in this area with normal shipping, more or less. And there is a huge difference whether you are in the black part of the Arctic or in the blue part of the Arctic. That is the part of the Arctic that is impacted by winter ice. So in the summertime, in the summer season, this area is also open for quite normal shipping. And the period where this area is open is becoming longer and longer as the development goes on. And then you have the colored part of the Arctic. That is multi-year ice. That is ice that doesn't melt in the summer. So it becomes harder and harder in the wintertime. And that is the kind of ice where you need very heavy icebreaker in order to actually navigate. And as you can see, it has a tendency to clock in the Canadian American part of the Arctic, and that is probably where it will be most difficult to be. But that can also be an advantage, because then there is maybe not so much activity there. So this is both, let's say, challenges, but also opportunities. Okay, next slide, please. Then when we look about the sea transportation and the sea route issue, The northern sea route going through the Russian territorial waters in some places, but close to the Russian coast. The Russians have not made this integrated transportation system in order for us European or Asian consumers to have 40% cheaper washing machines. They have made this because they need it themselves, because you cannot capitalize your resources in the Arctic if you can't get it on ships, and therefore they actually have been in the need of or been reliant on this sea transportation system for decades. And this is also the reason why the Russians have much more ice-breaking capacity than the rest of the Arctic nations, because they actually need icebreakers in order to get the shipping out of the area with the resources that they want to bring to the world market. So they are in a very special position because they are so heavily dependent on their resources, and therefore also to get it out in the region. And of course they want to use the residual capacity to sell it to shipping companies that wants to utilize this shortage of distance. But it is not constructed for that purpose, and you can get that impression sometimes when you are reading the quick headlines and the short analysis, and it is very important to understand this. You also see that there is two other options, and the northwest passage and the route that is going along the Canadian and the American coast. But as you saw on my ice chart before, I would argue that the blue transpolar sea route would probably be opening up before you can really use the northwest passage for systematic transportation. But I think that systematic transportation in this part of the world will have to wait at least 10 to 20 years before it becomes really interesting. But this is also the horizon that you are working on in boardrooms in shipping industry. So when you are investing in new shipping, you have to decide already now whether you want to be on a competitive edge when it comes to the future transportation pattern. And maybe you will have success, or maybe you will have invested in ships that you can't use. So this is basically, I think, what is impacting also civilian and commercial life in general. If you look at the next slide, you can see that there is a governing system in place. The Arctic Council have been there since 1996. The flags on top here is the permanent members. That is eight member states. And the countries on the side was the countries that was obtained in the Arctic Council as permanent observers at the Kiruna Summit in 2013. And here you see countries like Singapore, Japan, South Korea, India, China, and Italy. And then some of you would argue, why is Italy interested in the Arctic? Is that the Q phenomena in the Soviet Union that we are talking about here? But if you then take into consideration that Italy is probably the number one country when it comes to cruise industry, there could be a reason for Italy to actually be part of this club, because this is also where you discuss polar codes and good shipping and so forth. EU is in brackets because they went on a standby position because they have a ban against sealskin products. And as long as EU have a ban on sealskin products, Canada and Greenland will not let them in as permanent observers in this group. Then on the left side, you have the Arctic Five. That is the Arctic nation that actually have coastline to the polar seas, and through that have very hardcore border issues when it comes to the polar seas. Go to the next slide, please. And you often hear that this area is a Wild West area where you have loads of gold waiting to be picked up by the first to get there. But this is actually a very, very well-regulated area, and it is regulated through the UNCLOS, the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea from 1982. And what you see here is basically the colored areas along the coastlines is the exclusive economical zones out to 200 nautical miles. And the nations, they own all the resources within that zone, be that marine resources like fish and resources on the seabed and resources under the seabed. And more than 90% of the energy resources offshore in the Arctic region is actually within already established and general accepted exclusive economical zones. So the race for resources in the Arctic, the scramble for resources that is often depicted in the quick headlines, that would, in my opinion, be a commercial race. It will be a race to get the concessions to be part of the business up there, because you have already pulled out all the factors that is consisting the equation of conflict when it comes to resources, because they are already distributed to their rightful owner, you could argue. Then you have the striped area in the middle of the polar seas, and that is the area that is up for debate. That is the area outside the exclusive economical zones, where you can go as far as 100 nautical miles further out if you can prove by scientific data to the Continental Shelf Commission under the UN that your seabed is actually hooked up on your continental shelf. And in that case, you will get the right to regulate any activities on the seabed, but you will not own any fish by that. So it's important to understand that the resources out there, they are probably there, but they will not be, you will not be able to exploit them within the next 50 years, I would argue. So this is not about money. This is not about becoming rich tomorrow. This is national pride. This is politics. This is power politics. This is a matter of getting what belongs to you when the window is open. And if you can expand your territory without going to war for it, you should be there as a politician very quickly. I think that is close to be my 10 minutes of introduction. And if you take the next slides, I just have listed some of my points here. And my main conclusion is that since the resources is already distributed, and since Russia already owns the brother part of it, they are the one country in the Arctic region that have the most interest in a stable development of the Arctic region, because they have more resources in their part of the Arctic region than they can afford to exploit. So they need foreign investments, they need technological cooperation with Western companies in order to exploit it, and they can't do that if you have conflict and tension in the area. So that is why Russia is playing by the book for the moment, and I think they will continue to do that, because the whole Russian business model as a nation is hooked up to be able to unfold the full potential of their Arctic resources. So a future conflict Arctic region will be because of the spillover from something else, from another region and from another part of the world. And that could be a deepening of the Ukraine crisis or a strategic shock in the Chinese South China Sea, but it will not be because of something happening in the Arctic. Thank you very much.
Next up will be Commissioner Hutchinson.
You
can do either one, whichever you're most comfortable in. If you want, we could just go back. If you just show the slide, don't close it all together, because, Commissioner, you don't have slides, right?
No, I don't.
So go back to the one that shows the chart number 3 there, please. That one, just for reference.
Can everybody hear me okay if I stay here? Hello? Okay, closer. The good old Shure 58, right? The microphone of rock and roll. So the ambassador's comments put me in mind of a couple of things. I come from Ottawa, and we too speak to ambassadors. When I go to embassies in Ottawa and speak to ambassadors, they don't usually say the Arctic is hot. They usually say, if Santa Claus has a passport, it comes from our embassy. There are a lot of one-liners, though, when we talk about the Arctic, and you may have heard a few of them this week. You Hill staffers, I'd ask you to write this one down. Icebreakers are like beer. They don't come in ones. And that's not the Canadian fleet I'm talking about. Another one-liner I heard this week, perhaps a bit more serious, is that working in the Arctic is a bit like the law of the sea. particularly when we're talking about sovereignty. Yes, it comes with some freedom, but it also comes with a lot of obligation. But the one-liner I heard that really stuck with me, and I have to attribute it to Admiral Sonas, who's here in the front row, is he said, it's best to view the Arctic as high attention, low tension. High attention, low tension. And that's the period we're in right now, and that's going to be the theme of my remarks this afternoon. And there's a remarkable similarity to the title of the last presentation, which was Cooperation or Conflict. Conflict or Cooperation, pardon me. When we talk about low tension, high attention, I think it's a great description. I think it's possibly somewhat aspirational, particularly if there are ambassadors talking about the Arctic as being hot. But if we think about it for too long, it's probably a little bit apocryphal as well. By which I mean that the current situation offers us an opportunity, and it may not last forever. There may be points of national pride. There may be political points to score, but there may ultimately be resources that countries will see as a primary means of maintaining a way of life and a standard of living. And what may be cooperative today may have a different potential tomorrow. And the suggestion I want to make, and I know others have made it, I simply am adding my voice to what I hope is a growing number, is that we have to strengthen the cooperation now to minimize the conflict that may or may not develop. People talk about the unclosed process, for example. Is it the best process we could have right now? It's better than not having a process, I'll tell you that. It's suggested sometimes that UNCLOS is too slow, and I say thank God. A process that is going to potentially pick winners and losers when we're talking about a region like the Arctic ought to be slow, so we have time to build the relationships and the common understanding. From where we sit, not on that picture. From where we sit, the primary threats to security in the Arctic are not necessarily military. We think, military. And I think the previous presentation spoke to this as well, that in the nearer term, we may be talking about tourism and the risks that it raises. We may be talking about economic development. We certainly would add to a list like that the potential impacts on indigenous ways of life. There are northern communities in Canada, as you know, that have a sacred and traditional way of life, and it's been said that, what a shame that way of life won't evolve quickly enough to adapt to the changing economic conditions. I don't think that that's a perspective we share as a country. We see a way of life that fits into a broader conversation. And we see it supported by some of the work that's going on. We think one of the primary areas for cooperation right now is in the science realm. We can talk about economic development in the Arctic, but I'd pose the question, do we really have the scientific basis that we need to see large-scale development in some of the areas that are being talked about? And my answer to that question would be no, that we can't let economic development get ahead of what we actually understand well enough to develop. We can take some easy examples, the behavior of oil in Arctic water, the behavior of oil when it hits the ice. And we're very grateful for the cooperation that already exists around some of these issues. The Arctic Coast Guard Forum may be small, but it's mighty, and the level of cooperation there, the conversations that are happening, are conversations that, frankly, we don't think can happen in other places. We have people in the room, we have ongoing conversation that maybe right now can only occur because it is the Coast Guards collectively that have the primary role in the Arctic. Our Coast Guard, as you know, is a civilian operation. We work very closely with our partners, the Royal Canadian Navy, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, but we are the government presence that's been in the Arctic the longest for the Canadian government. 55 years of operations in the Arctic. You saw the map. It shows that the harshest ice conditions continue to be in our archipelago. And we sometimes say, I have a background in law, and we used to say in law that you can have 20 years of legal experience, or you can have 1 year of legal experience 20 years over. And I can tell you, it takes 35 years of operations in the Arctic to actually get a senior captain that's capable of operating, that knows that terrain. And you know, going back to the point of cooperation and the science space, one of the ways that we spend time in the Arctic, we have 7 icebreakers that operate there seasonally, as was pointed out before, several of which have a science mission. Just to perhaps draw my comments to a close, I'll pick up again on the point of cooperation. The Coast Guard Forum has allowed us to move forward in operationalizing agreements around search and rescue. There isn't a partner in the Arctic that hasn't relied on somebody else at some point. The most recent example of that is a Canadian vessel relying on a Danish frigate cutter to help out in a time of great need. The Canadians have offered that assistance when required to do so, the Americans, the Russians. There isn't anybody up there that hasn't lent a hand to help, and it really strengthens the search and rescue platform. No single country, irrespective of their icebreaker fleet, has the reach to cover that region. We say, if you don't see the need for partnership in the Arctic, you're not standing close enough. It's really big when you get there. And secondly, I already alluded to this, the environmental response piece. There's no way for one country to cover all of the risk. And it's an area where we're very grateful for the level of collaboration that we have. We certainly believe in pushing it forward, because the answer to the question, how ready is ready, keeps changing. And we want to be in the forefront of that conversation, but not alone, not by any means. We have partners that need to be there with us. So back to the opening point, low tension, high attention. And to get there, I think we have to remember that it's not a linear solution to a linear question. We don't go from sovereignty to economic development to military presence. We go from environmental response to search and rescue to indigenous cultures to economic development, keeping in mind that the Arctic could be the next place we collectively exploit, or it could be the first place that we develop responsibly. Thank you.
Admiral Gallaudet.
All right, good afternoon, everybody. I'm gonna make a non-traditional introduction here, and I want to recognize our American Sign Language interpreters here. This is the first event I think I've ever been to where we've had that presence. And it's close to my heart because my name, Gallaudet, I'm a ancestor of Thomas Hopkins Gallaudet, who founded, founded Gallaudet University just a few miles up in DC, Northwest. And it was the first college for the deaf. And it was interesting, and this does relate to the Arctic, I'll get to the point, but Thomas Hopkins Gallaudet was an Episcopalian minister, and in his age, in the late 18th century, deaf people were regarded as being mentally retarded. Because they just didn't have a way to communicate. And he was the first person to get that. And that's how we developed American Sign Language, and here we are. And so you have now many deaf people who are highly functioning and contributing to our great society. So he was an innovator, and he looked at things differently. And that's what we have to do with the Arctic. It's changing, you know, it's different now. It's a different environment, and so we're really gonna have to look at it differently to move forward. Collectively, so kind of a parallel there. If you take anything home from what I say today, so welcome, and it's good to have you here. Okay, next slide, please. All right. So first off, let's just talk about the ice and the changing environment here. You know, rarely do we really talk about what we expect in the coming decades. It's usually just we kind of dance around the hard climate prediction of what's going to happen, and it is harder because there's a lot of uncertainty. And so one of the first things we did when we developed our Arctic roadmap, the U.S. Navy's perspective on approach to the changing Arctic, is we kind of synthesized all the science and the climate predictions so we could just have something to plan to. And this is it. We call it our unambiguous assessment of Arctic ice. And you know, it's much that Admiral Wang had talked to, in that the Northern Sea Route already open, and this is a depiction of what we expect from 2020 to 2025 to 2030 on ice coverage during the minimal peak in the season, which is in around September. So September ice coverage is here throughout the next couple decades. And you know, you can see the Russians are gonna gain a lot. The Northern Sea Route is opening up extensively. It's still gonna be pretty zesty up in the Canadian Arctic. And then we'll have the polar route opening, or you know, within a decade or so, for longer periods in the summer. And so that's a big change, and this is something we're planning towards. Okay, next slide, please. Now, you hear this, oh my God, OMG title of the slide is not a DOD acronym. It's actually a NASA acronym. So don't tell me DOD corners the market on bad acronyms. But what it stands for is Observing Melting Glaciers, and it's an actual NASA project. At any rate, it's significant, though, because they're really trying to assess this contribution to sea level rise of melting glaciers. And I've also depicted on the left-hand side of this chart the decreasing ice extent and also the decreasing ice volume on the lower part, which is the more significant statistic, because the volume is what has decreased the most rapidly. There's still a good amount of coverage during the winter, but it's all young ice and it's not that thick. And so it's the volume that's decreased the most dramatically. And that's really been the bellwether for climate change in the Arctic and the planet. And it's just been substantive. I think since the records first started, satellite records in 1980, the volume has decreased 40%, which is really astonishing. So that's what we're having to work with. Next slide. So some of the strategic drivers that we've addressed, you know, the environmental change I just spoke to, The Russian resurgence around the world is something to consider. And I have to echo the words of my fellow panelists. It's interesting. We see they're challenging us in places like the Baltic and the Eastern Mediterranean. But it's my experience is in the Arctic, that's not really occurring. Yes, they've rebuilt their military. But what I found, and it was my own personal visit to St. Petersburg about a year and a half ago, is that they don't want to burn their relationships in the Arctic. Now, they're acting much differently elsewhere, but in the Arctic, they want to communicate. And so they actually share oceanographic data with us that they had collected during a cruise around the world. They were very cooperative and with everyone, and they really didn't do any of the provocative activity that we were expecting. So it was an interesting change. So there's a number of ways to look at Russia and the Arctic. But then the commercial and recreational activity is something that I know our Coast Guard brothers are having to look at closely, because they will be the search and rescue lead should something happen. And again, this Crystal Serenity cruise this summer is just pointing, you know, is a sign of things to come. And more of that means more risk and likelihood of something bad happening. So that's kind of what we're thinking about when we approach the Arctic. Next slide. So what we've done is we've drafted a new roadmap for our approach to the Arctic, and we based it off all the existing strategy. There's no shortage of it, as you can see listed here. These documents all talk about the changing Arctic in various degrees. I'll add to this, though, something that's not here, and that is Secretary Mattis talked about the Arctic during his confirmation hearing, and he said something quite bold. The U.S. Defense Department just released a new strategy in January, and afterwards, when he was testifying, he said that he really believes that we need to take a new integrated strategic approach to the Arctic, and he's going to make it a priority. Now, I haven't heard any word on that yet, because he's been going all around the world meeting with his counterparts, but you know, stand by, because he may be taking a round turn on that. It probably is going to somehow be related to what Admiral Wang talked about, and that was Trump Effect 1 and 2, since, you know, they're pretty close there. Next slide. So here's our implementation plan of this roadmap, and we've had three different phases in the near, mid, and long term. A lot of words here. I'll just sort of condense it tightly. Right now, our focus is twofold. It's on increasing our experience through exercises and international cooperation, as well as assessing our future requirements and really building better capability to understand the changes. So that's environmental modeling and prediction. And that's where our first initial investments are going now. But in the midterm, you know, we're going to be looking at becoming more deliberate in our approach with expanded surface air and submarine presence. We have robust submarine presence now and some air presence, but we'll be growing more in the midterm and get to an end state in the beyond 2030 time frame where we have more persistent presence with our surface forces. So that's our plan. It will require some level of investments, I think, in the more midterm period. The investments we're making right now are primarily along the maritime and Arctic domain awareness and environmental prediction. Next slide. So recent things, again, I'm really focused on our submarine force and the observation and modeling of the ice, weather, and ocean. It's hard to see there, but I have two graphics. They're pictures of the Arctic ice camp in March. The one in the middle, on top, shows the camp when it was first established, early March, and the arrow points to the position in the Chukchi Sea where the camp was established. And during the month-long period our camp was there and the submarines were surfacing through the ice, you can see how far it drifted. And then the lower picture on the lower left shows the camp when the ice broke up underneath it and they had to evacuate. So this is two consecutive ice exercises we've done where the ice broke apart in the middle of the camp and they had to do emergency evacuation. Nothing unprecedented in the decades-long experience of doing these ice camps. And so it's just a pretty dramatic example of how the environment is changing up there. And I was on the boat that surfaced through the ice. I talked to the submarine skippers and the Arctic ice pilots who've been doing this for decades, and they have never seen the environment like it is today. It's very dynamic. The ice is moving quickly and rapidly, and it's pretty much a hazardous navigation environment for our boats. And then I have some depiction on the right-hand side, this marginal ice zone study that the Office of Naval Research is conducting. So we're really doubling down on our ability to observe and understand what's going on up there. Next slide. In the future, we got a number of things going forward. We're going to have another ICEX in 2018. I have an unmanned aerial vehicle there to show that we're going to really look at the observations using those kind of platforms, as well as unmanned underwater vehicles. And then we have the Naval Postgraduate School is conducting a number of experiments there, along with the Office of Naval Research. Northern Edge is going to kick off in May 1st. So that's a big joint Pacific Command, Alaska Command sponsored exercise, and we'll have several thousand soldiers, sailors, and airmen participating in that just to gain Arctic experience. And then Exercise Cold Response. And actually underway right now is an exercise called Arctic Care, where all the joint force medical communities are providing local medical treatment to the various villages in Alaska. So gaining experience here as we move forward. Next slide. So lastly, I want to finish something that's more of an umbrella framework for the Arctic. Our CNO, John Richardson, depicted here, he's looked at how the environment in general, the ocean, is so, it really affects all of our operations. And the fact that our competitors are catching up in their ability to observe and predict it. So it's ocean modeling, it's atmospheric modeling, ice, and weather. And so he's asked me to stand up a task force, it's Task Force Ocean, that the Navy's leading to improve our science, to improve our ability to predict the changing conditions around the world. This has an undersea focus, but we look at the Arctic right now, and not only is the sea surface changing with the ice, but we've noticed new oceanographic conditions under the ice due to the freshening of the water and the changing ice on top of it. And that's having our submarine force have to develop new tactics to work with the different acoustic conditions. So this task force is addressing that along with several other issues, but it's a main effort, and we're working closely with all the academic institutions that have longstanding relationships with the Navy, like Wiz Hole and Scripps and University of Washington and others, to just up our game in ocean science so we better understand the operating environment and exploit it to our advantage. Okay, next slide. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Tim. And last but not least, Mr. Mike Emerson, U.S. Coast Guard.
So I'd like to start by thanking the Navy League for having added the Arctic security issue as a topic here today, and especially thanks to newly promoted Captain Jacob Rousseau from Denmark who actually had the original idea a year ago and really pushed this topic. The Arctic is a success story right now, and I'd like you to think as you consider the Q&A period coming up, think of the Arctic and security according to the following. First, as has been mentioned, the security in the Arctic really goes beyond military security. If security is freedom from threats and hazards, then you have to look at the Arctic for what it is. The Bering Sea is the great commissary of the Great Commons, source of significant amount of protein that could be a very attractive source of food and sustainment for a lot of other countries. China has indicated that the Arctic Ocean belongs to the globe, not necessarily to the five coastal states that currently have sovereign claims to the borders of the Arctic and including Russia and the United States, who share a very strategic choke point, if you will, a strait in the Bering that allows entry and exit to the Arctic. So think about security within the context of the resources that are there. We've talked a little bit about resource development. Sure, maybe it's 10, 15 years off, or maybe it's not. Strategic minerals, there's certainly the petrochemicals, there's certainly LNG and a lot of things that Russia is already taking advantage of, and they have a relationship with China right now. China's 20% invested in the LNG production on the Siberian coast, and that might be a marriage of convenience that we should pay attention to. Certainly from a security concern, I think the Arctic is a security concern to Russia. I think that I call them the big four. There's the resource development, the fishing. I mentioned the commissary, and as the Arctic warms and ice recedes, we expect fish populations to migrate north, and so too will the opportunistic fishermen. There's certainly going to be more shipping in the Northern Sea Route, and perhaps across the pole, and then in the Northwest Passage, and finally tourism. And we've seen that. We'll see it again this year. And if it's one ship or if it's five, you're certainly going to want to have your Coast Guard there. So is the Arctic a security issue for the Coast Guard? Absolutely. The development of ice-capable ships is something that we've managed to not expand on in the recent past. For the past 40 years, we've relied on two heavy icebreakers, the Polar Sea and Polar Star. And those years are numbered now. The future of those is short, and we are looking at a significant recapitalization of our ice-capable surface fleet. That would be heavy icebreakers. You mentioned 3 and 3, sir, and that's certainly the starting argument for all of our high-latitude, both North and South Pole capabilities. But you have to have some sort of response capability for any sort of mishap. A transpolar flight, a Northwest Passage tourist vessel, or any of the other things, the shipping and the fishing and the other traffic that might occur in the Arctic. We think about the Arctic in terms of Alaska because most of us are from this area or the United States. But I would tell you the Arctic security issue is different in different regions. I can tell you that because we host the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and keeping peace in the Arctic isn't easy. Keeping inviting and coordinating participation, active participation by all 8 Arctic nations, Coast Guard-like agencies, is a tall order. It's a significant accomplishment of the chairmanship, the U.S. chairmanship of the Arctic Council, that we did launch the Arctic Coast Guard Forum and that we did have the Russians sitting next to the Canadians, sitting next to the United States, and sitting next to our Scandinavian brothers from the other services, and being able to talk about operationalizing some of the programs that the Arctic Council sponsors. So we do have some plans in place to not only work together jointly to cooperate and share resources for search and rescue and oil spills and other contingencies, but to actively exercise those to do training exercises using mixed resources and to be able to work at a tactical level on a daily basis despite what's happening in other regions. So as you look at the Arctic and you looked at the chart that Admiral Wang put up from Denmark showing the other perspective, the Black Arctic, think carefully about what Finland and Russian relations and interest in the Arctic might be, and Norway and Russia, or any of the other Scandinavian countries, not just about Alaska. Finally, I would say that the success that we've had in the Arctic is largely because it's so far been easy. The advantage of talking about this today and in the recent past is that we can plan for the future and not mess it up. We can work together in the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, as Admiral Hutchinson mentioned. We can cooperate together. We can keep the Arctic peaceful. And I think we can do that by acknowledging the strengths of the UNCLOS framework. The U.S. should take great pride in the fact that we ushered in that framework and we got it socialized with so many countries that verified it, and we should follow suit ourselves. The Coast Guard is a strong proponent of having an amicable and a peaceful relationship so that there are no amphibious assaults on Alaska or any attacks on our Alaska homeland. In fact, we can continue to live 47 miles from our Russian neighbors and share a common border with our Canadian neighbors and continue to do so to mutual benefit. So if you leave here with nothing else, leave here with an understanding that there are four big drivers, changes in human activity that I've mentioned regarding some fairly serious and significant security interest. They're more economic, they're resource related, but they certainly are relevant to all of us, no matter what region. Thank you.
Okay, we'll turn over to questions. Just to kind of reiterate what you've heard here, I just want to, I took down a couple of notes to refresh you, because I think there's been some profound statements. On the one hand, we had that the sovereignty claims have all been made. There's really nothing other than commercial competition to be had up there. On the other hand, you heard that some countries feel like the Arctic belongs to everybody. You heard that this is a region where there's a tension without tension. And the kind of collectively, I think they all agreed that the Arctic Coast Guard Forum has a potential to serve this part of the world. And then you got an unambiguous, regardless of where you stand on the issues that gets us here, what you got from the Oceanographer of the Navy is an unambiguous forecast of the ice conditions in the future. That's about as clear as it gets, I think. And then to kick in, you got a little bit of history on sign language, and you got some NASA acronyms, so you can't beat that. So with that, we'll turn it over to you. This is audience participation part. How about your questions? You will not find a better panel than this. Yes, sir. Could you please, sir, if it's not too much trouble, could I get you to use the microphone? Right behind you. We'll get somebody to bring. Can you help him out here? So everybody can hear your question.
I heard in the past that Canada was not really friendly on allowing persons to go through the so-called Northwest Passage, and I'm trying to find out, is that this situation been resolved? Are they happy with allowing, are they accepting the international shipping going through the so-called Northwest Passage if it comes to that, or is that going to still be an issue? Is that a settled issue? Or Thank you.
I don't think we're able to say it's a settled issue from some other country's perspectives. It's certainly settled from the Canadian perspective.
Are they going to allow shipping through there, or are they going to say no?
We've never not allowed shipping through the archipelago, but the archipelago is subject to a set of rules that we refer to as the Northern Regs. The NORDREG is usually how it's referred to. The Canadian law aligns pretty closely with the Polar Code, and the Polar Code sets an international standard for how shipping will happen in the Arctic. It's not 100% true, I think, to say that if you follow the polar code, you follow the Canadian law, but you're in the right zone for sure. But under NORDREG, there's a requirement to report in, and there's a requirement for Canadians to respond to that hail. So far, it operates sometimes a bit similarly to don't ask, don't tell, or something like that. Countries respect the obligation to hail, and we respect their wishes to travel through that part of the world. We usually deploy icebreakers in such a way that we can be at the ready should that need arise, because as the interest in the north increases, the likelihood of mariners on the bridges of ships that aren't familiar with that area increases as well. So between the Americans and the Canadians, we've got pretty good positioning, but that's essentially how it operates.
Thank you. And Admiral Wang, you had a comment on that?
It's just to, I think the question is hitting right on the nail here, because you have actually the same standpoints both in Canada and in Russia that the Northwest Passage and the Northeast Passage, or the Northern Sea Route, is going through territorial water respectively. And maybe it's an advantage that United States and Canada can agree on disagree on this issue. Because let's say in 10 or 15 years, when the Chinese starts to challenge the Northwest Passage, then United States can actually let the Canadian protest, because United States, they will never give in on the right of innocent passage through these international straits. So it might come in handy in some years. So maybe you just should leave it there.
My name is Lipo Liu of the Voice of America. It seems to me that most of you are not really concerned about Russia at this moment. But what about China? And Emerald Wang, I think you mentioned that several times, but I wonder what's your understanding of China's intentions are in the Arctic, and particularly with President Xi visiting Finland at the moment. And I'm also wondering whether you are concerned about China's future activities, particularly because you mentioned that conflict in South China Sea may spill over to the Arctic. And then welcome other panelists' comments. Thanks.
Is there a particular person you'd like to answer that question?
Yes, Admiral Wang and other panelists.
Thank you very much. Well, I think that China's interest in the Arctic is exactly the same as China's interest in any other region with resources. And if you notice the pattern globally, China goes in where United States is not present or where United States pulls out. You see that in South America, you see that in Africa, and you will also, of course, see that in the Arctic. When United States pulled back from Iceland in 2006, and the rest of us abandoned Iceland after the financial crisis in 2008, who was there with an unselfish rendering hand? It was China. And today, you have a quite significant Chinese soft power, diplomacy, economic impact in Iceland. And it makes sense seen from a Chinese perspective, I think, because if you use the rule of exclusion, they will never get a foothold in the Arctic in Russia. They would not get it in Norway, they will not get it in United States, and they will not get it in Canada. So what is left? Then you can start to see that there might be a possibility to actually influence a small community like the Icelandic community. And you also start to seeing some of the same indicators in Greenland because of the Greenlandic special relationships within the Danish realm. Whether you should be concerned about that or not, as long as it is being done on commercial terms, and in competition with other investments, you could argue to a certain extent it's our own medicine, it's competition, it's free market. But of course, it also once in a while become very strategic and very security oriented. For example, if China is investing in rare earth mineral deposits with uranium connected to it in Greenland, is it then just a matter of commodities, or is it a matter of security policy? If China owns one harbor in Iceland, is it then a transportational issue? If they own all harbors in Iceland, they do not, but if they did, would it then be a security issue? So I think there is a moving border here, and it is very difficult to give an exact recipe on when this becomes an issue. But I don't think that China will actually, let's say, obtain resources in the Arctic region with the use of violence. Why should they? They can just buy it.
So I'll give a Navy perspective, which echoes Admiral Wang's, in that the U.S. Navy is concerned about China's future activity in the Arctic. We look at their growing population and their exponential increase in demand for resources, and our concern is that if they are currently acting unlawfully in the South China Sea, will they do the same for resource extraction in the Arctic in the future? So that's a big concern of ours. Second, let me go back to your comment about Russia saying we're not concerned about Russia. I'm not concerned so much about Russia in the Arctic, but the U.S. Navy is concerned about Russia elsewhere. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Chief of Royal Norwegian Navy. First of all, let me congratulate you with the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and I think that's the key success to the Arctic, to have nations on a legal framework with their legal agencies meet and make a good resource management in a legal matter. I think all of us wish that to be the future. But I have a comment, Nils Wang, you were mentioning that there could be a spillover from other things, and we're all in a new security situation. So let me give you this challenge. Russia have always had the strategic challenge of connecting their Pacific fleet to their Atlantic fleet. In 10 years' time, there will be open ocean from Severomorsk to the Pacifics. So why is one of the Arctic nations building a huge military force today with big air defense bases in New Siberian Islands, Franz Josef Land, new fighter, jet fighter aircraft bases, Arctic brigades, Arctic amphibious brigades in the Arctic? And the other four is doing nothing. Is that a challenge?
Sure. Go ahead, everyone.
Thank you. Well, Lars, that's a good question. I think you're absolutely right. If you can bring goods with commercial shipping from the Atlantic to the Pacific through the Northern Sea Route, why shouldn't you transport military equipment? And I think actually, and that is my personal view, that the acquisition of the French helicopter carrier class, where one of them was supposed to be ice reinforced, could actually be seen in that specific perspective that you are mentioning here. Because if you're standing up an Arctic brigade and you have a helicopter carrier, then you suddenly have at least operational, but maybe even strategic, a reserve that you can actually shift. And if that is the case, you could argue that you would see even more military equipment on the Russian side in the Arctic, because then it becomes a distribution center for Arctic or for military outreach in both the Pacific and the Atlantic arena. And that could maybe make it more affordable for them to have a military. So I think that could be an issue that you have to look upon in the future. The bases along the Northern Sea Route, you can use air bases for anything. You can use it for offensive means or for defensive means. I'm sure that some part of the reason for re-establishing these bases is also to actually get maritime domain awareness, because they want to know what is going outside in the Northern Sea Route, so they can get the entrance fee. And it is also something about the Coast Guard task to actually maintain constabulary tasks like search and rescue and so forth. But of course you can use it for other things. But I also think if you look at it from a Russian perspective, if my theory is correct that the Northern Sea Route is a strategic umbilical for the whole Russian national business model for the next 50 years. Why shouldn't they defend it with power if necessary? I mean, no one will leave a strategic seaway like that just undefended. So I'm not just buying in on the militarization theory, but of course not either the opposite. So it's something in between. I don't know if that answers your question, but that's a comment at least.
Do you mind if I comment too, Admiral Saunas? You raise a good point. Currently, we see their assess their buildup as a means to protect their sovereignty. And but you raise a great concern: is there potential in the future for a spillover effect to have those forces used for a more offensive capability or scenario? And so, yes, that is a future concern. How is it near term, mid term? We don't know. That's something we have to look at closely. The other aspect of that is, how good will they be as they train and develop up there, their northern forces? You know, we currently assess their undersea forces being highly capable and in great competition with ours. We're not so worried about the surface force right now. And so as we move forward, we'll have to look at hard at how good they are and what kind of competition it is.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is John Brinke. I'm from Ingalls Shipbuilding, and that's way down in the subtropics. But wanted to ask a question. Vice Admiral Ray, when you started talking about icebreakers, you mentioned the 3+3 requirement. Then Mr. Emerson, you alluded that might be just the beginning of the conversation. And if I remember correctly, I think when you add the Coast Guard requirements and the naval operating requirements, you might end up with 6+4. But could I get the U.S. Coast Guard and the U.S. Navy to talk about, to get the job done in the Arctic, how many ships we think we need?
Sure. Mike, you want to answer?
Yeah, I'll take that. Thanks. The current high-latitude analysis that we have suggests that for presence, for establishing the presence, taking a lesson from the Russians and looking at your maritime domain awareness capabilities and your ability to respond to your sovereign waters for protection purposes. They're building icebreakers. We need to build icebreakers. We're looking at 3 heavy and 3 medium. And I am responsible, again, for domestic icebreaking as well. So there'll be a litany of smaller, less capable icebreakers or ice-capable ships that the Coast Guard's going to have to look at in the near term. They're aging, and we're vastly overdue in getting programs together. So for right now, the polar capabilities is 3+3, sir.
And I can give you the Navy perspective. So in the Arctic, we deem our current presence with our submarine force primarily, some seasonal presence with the surface force, and some presence with the air forces as being sufficient today. But in the future, we have not yet assessed what the Arctic requirement will be. We have assessed what our overall ship count numbers should be. And so from our current state of 274 ships, the U.S. Navy is embarking on a plan to get to a requirement of 355. And so there's very serious talk in the Pentagon right now on how we're gonna do that, acknowledging that our first steps really have to be in getting readiness today, so having sufficient spares to maintain what we have in the fleet now, and then modernizing our capabilities so they're sufficiently lethal and capable. Those first two steps, once they're met, then we'll start growing our ship numbers. And that's what we will do. How much the Arctic plays in that, we're not sure yet.
I'm Ted Kay, I'm from Sayers, and the question is about communications infrastructure. What is the future for our infrastructure in the Arctic to support increased ship activity, increased support of search and rescue, et cetera? It's a demanding environment, a lot different than the lower latitudes, and I was just wondering, in the plan, what was the future for communications and supporting maritime domain awareness?
I'd recommend we kind of all three countries take a stab at that, if you don't mind. Commissioner Hutchinson, can you kind of tell them looking ahead for Canada, please?
Certainly. We operate mainly from a terrestrial-based system. We're renewing many of those assets over the next few years, moving them to greener sources of energy. And we expect to move to more satellite-based AIS in the medium term. That's essentially where we are from a civilian side.
I can't really comment on the non-U.S. Navy elements of your question, because there's a larger U.S. answer here. But from a Navy perspective, we have in place and we have programmed the communication capabilities we require to operate effectively up there. And so there's satellite systems primarily, but also organic task force ship-based communications capabilities.
So we've got a litany or a full spectrum of unclassed capabilities for communications, navigation, and sensing that are a mix of satellite and terrestrial systems, as well as some projects that we're working on in low Earth orbit temporary solutions that fill gaps or black holes.
We are planning to improve our communication infrastructure with the use of satellites, and I think that the development within the satellite industry with smaller and smaller nanosatellites will actually come in handy. And I think you need to actually try and embrace public-private partnership here, because some of your solutions for the military and Coast Guard use can also be used in order to actually get infrastructure in remote areas for the population that actually lives up there, so you can create connectivity on internet and communication also there.
If I could add one more to that, though. So communications are absolutely essential for safe operations up there, understood. But what we're trying to get at where there's a bigger gap is being able to predict the environment, the hazardous weather, the ice conditions. I showed you the ice camp, and the 30-day, if we had an ability to predict out to 30 days what the ice under the camp was going to do, we would have been able to situate it in a better position. And so that's a capability that we don't have now and we need to drive towards. And there's a sensing piece, there's a modeling piece. And, you know, from a expert modeler perspective, you know, the weather and the ocean are fairly easy. They're fluid dynamics, equations of motions, and we got that pretty well wired. But ice is like a composite material. It's like plastic. It's incredibly difficult to model. We're just not there yet. So that's where we're really focusing a lot of Office of the Naval Research funding right now.
I'm Ken Prime, former Coast Guard, and now with Lockheed. I've heard our Coast Guard Commandant speak to the need of, I guess, bathymetry and just general overall mapping of the Arctic from what's down there. And you see all these northern sea routes in the Northwest Passage. Is there through that Coast Guard forum, is there a plan in place, multinational, to do any cooperative mapping of the Arctic for the general use, or is it going to be a close hold from one country to another? Thank you.
We haven't included that on the agenda, sir, and it's certainly a good one, but at present there's such a paucity of assets in the United States between NOAA and some of the ice-capable vessels the Coast Guard has to do that charting that we are in the single-digit percentages and likely to remain there. What we have done is take a look at some of the more busier areas in the Bering Sea and along the coast of Alaska and even the North Slope and launched into port access route studies, PARs. We finished one for the Bering Strait recently that identifies where the traffic typically goes, and now we've identified two-way routes that are going to be the focus for doing the good charting and then being able to guarantee the shippers and the insurers that if they stay in those recommended travel lanes, they'll be in good water. It's very shallow, unforgiving bottom in the Arctic typically, but in the Alaska and the North Slope area, that's where we aren't.
I would add to that, in picking up on the theme of cooperation, we're working with our American counterparts on something that we call low-impact shipping corridors. And I wouldn't typify it as a close hold of any sort. It's just that the Canadian and American coastlines result in common risks. If we talk about the Crystal Serenity for a second, it got a lot of attention in the United States, 32-day voyage, half of which it spent in Canadian waters. We know that even given the paucity of charting in the north, there are safer routes and there are less safe routes. The maps generally showed one or two routes through the Northwest Passage. In fact, there are 11 principal routes, and we know where the safer ones are and we know where the more dangerous ones are. If we can get the maritime industry to recognize, and Mike made reference to how insurance will work and that kind of thing, if we can get ships to stay in the safe shipping zones, then we can create low impact zones, I believe. And this is a perfect example of where bilateral cooperation isn't excluded from a multilateral conversation where there's a shared interest that's specific to a relatively small piece of geography in the Arctic.
So in addition to my other titles, I happen to be the hydrographer of the US Navy. And I share the national charting responsibility with National Geospatial Intelligence Agency and NOAA. NOAA is responsible for charting within U.S. EEZs. I collect bathymetry outside U.S. EEZs, and so that includes a large part of the Arctic. And then NGA processes that data into charts. Currently, worldwide, we've estimated that only 20% of the Earth's seafloor has been mapped to modern standards, and it's a lot less in the Arctic. NOAA has a very, they've published a superb plan to chart the U.S. Arctic, and they've already begun doing that, and so I really applaud them in that. With respect to the waters outside the U.S. EEZ, a number of the countries are sharing data, and we've been working very closely with Canada, for example, on mutual surveys to justify our extended continental shelf claims. But in fact, the meeting in St. Petersburg that I referred to was part of the larger international hydrographic organization, a subcomponent called the Arctic Regional Hydrographic Organization, or Commission. And so that's what we were doing in St. Petersburg, is talking about sharing hydrographic capabilities, standards, and data. And so there, we have a solid plan to work together to get there. And that's what was so surprising, is that Russia wanted to work with us on this.
Captain Wang, closing comments.
When I sailed in Greenlandic waters in my younger days, we often sailed in totally white charts. There was only one sounding line in a fjord or in an inner lead, and the only thing you knew as a skipper was that there has been at least one that have been moving along in that particular line without going aground, and the rest was up to you. I think also that if you only use conventional hydrographical techniques in order to undertake such a vast task that it is to get all the white areas colored with soundings, it simply takes too long time. I think the Greenlandic waters would be measured in 450 years with the tempo that they can produce. So I think that industry and research should actually come up with methods where you can maybe promise that in this area, through laser technique or whatever, you can say this is guaranteed 20 meters of water. That would be extremely helpful, because then you actually doesn't have to know the details further down. And that could be a start, and then you can focus your conventional, very accurate thing in the very trafficked areas.
Thank you, Admiral Wang. Well, this concludes our time. I just want to wrap with just a couple thoughts. First of all, you heard stated that one of the great strategic thinkers of our country in this day and age, our Secretary of Defense, has stated that the Arctic is an area of strategic significance. We've seen that there are potential challenges and potential benefits of being there. On the one hand, we've heard that people are operating merely in their economic benefit, and there's no reason to be concerned. On the other hand, we've heard that if they act illegally in this part of the world, what's to say that they won't act illegally in other parts of the world? And then finally, we talked a little bit about the ability to rapidly transport capability devised for commercial purposes to military purposes. So plenty to chew on there from a security perspective. But I think probably one of the most profound statements, and I'll walk with it and hopefully walk away from here with it, is that the Arctic is certainly not like any other place on this planet. And so maybe it is just another place we can exploit, or maybe it's a place that we get it right. So thank you, gentlemen, for shedding light on this important topic, and have a good day. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Awesome.